Everyone who hears these words of mine and does them is like a wise man who built his house on rock. The rain fell, the flood came, and the winds beat against that house, but it did not collapse because its foundation had been laid on rock. Everyone who hears my words of mine and does not do them is like a foolish man who built his house on sand. The rain fell, the flood came, and the winds beat against that house, and it collapsed. It was utterly destroyed. So basically, I want to start this evening by taking a quick inventory of those of us in the room to see how we're doing. Because what Jesus is saying here is like, if you hear my words and put them into practice, then you're going to survive the storms of life. But if you don't, it's like you built your house on sand and you will be destroyed. So we're going to do a little audience participation. I need you to stand up for me if you have ever told a lie. All right, sit down. Okay. I want you to stand up for me if you have ever been jealous of somebody else's life to the point that you wish you had what they did. All right, sit down. Stand up if in your anger you have ever hurt someone. All right, sit down. Stand up if you have ever eaten shellfish, shrimp, lobster, crab, yeah. Sit down. Last one, real quick. Stand up if you have ever been disrespectful or dishonoring to your parents. All right, sit down. I mean, yikes. Am I right? I mean, there's 613 laws. We could have written, like, read all of them, but, like, I just gave you a couple, and almost all of you are standing for almost all of them. And so if I read what Jesus is saying, he's like, you've heard my words. You haven't put them into practice. Therefore, you're like the foolish man who built his house on sand, and it will be destroyed, utterly and completely destroyed. This is a message of hope. I'm just kidding. So, like, what do we do with that, right? Like, if we know that we've already screwed up, if we know that there are things that God has made very clear to us, and yet we're not fully following them, and this is saying, if you don't, it's like you're building a house on sand and you're going to be destroyed, what hope do we have? And here's what's even crazier, is right before this, hear what Jesus says in verse 21. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter into the kingdom of heaven. Only the one who does the will of my Father in heaven. On that day, many will say to me, Lord, Lord, didn't we prophesy in your name and cast out demons in your name and do many powerful deeds in your name? Then I will declare to them, I never knew you. Go away from me, you lawbreakers. Like, hold up. So there's people who are actually doing the things that God has told people to do. And Jesus is saying, on that day, I will say, get away from me. I never knew you. So how in the world, if we are sitting here with the full knowledge that there are words of God that we have not faithfully put into practice in our own lives, And there are people who are out there doing things in the name of Jesus that are consistent with his word and can still be told, get away from me, I never knew you. How do we become like the wise builder who built his house on the rock? And when the rains came and the winds came and the floods came, the house was not destroyed. To me, it all comes down to truly understanding who this king is, who Jesus actually is, because he ultimately is the rock, and he's inviting us to build our life on him, to root ourselves deep into who he is. And the reality is, for a lot of us, that's the blue alert. We're all good. We're safe in here. Great. Here's the reality. You know that you have sand in your life, right? Like, we're all aware of aspects of our life that we are putting our hope and our trust and our faith in that is not secure, it is not steady, it is like sand slipping through our fingers. It might be your athletic ability, and then all of a sudden an injury happens that ends your athletic career. It might be your grades, and then all of a sudden a test comes along that you can't ace. It might be a relationship that you feel so secure, and then all of a sudden it ends. Sand. It's sand. And if we're honest, we're really good at identifying the things that have let us down. That if we're honest, have been sand in our lives. But there's another aspect that if we're not careful, we might think we're on a rock. And it won't be until the storm comes that we understand that actually what we've been trusting in is sand. And that's our view of God. You see, a lot of us, we have a messed up view of who our King is, of who God actually is. And if we don't get that right, then when the storms of life hit, he's not going to be enough for us. So for some of you, here's an example. God to you is distant. He is far off. He is one of those gods who just like doesn't hear you. You're convinced he doesn't care about you. You have been praying a prayer over and over and over, asking him to show up, and he hasn't. You've been longing to feel something and you haven't. And so you have just settled on this idea that this God that we're talking about is just some distant God who doesn't really care. Because after all, if he did, right, he would fix things. He would change things. He would answer the prayers that I'm praying. And he's not, therefore he's distant. The problem with that is that if you hold on to that view of God, it is sand. When the storms come, you are not going to latch on or root in to a God who doesn't care. You're gonna let go. You're gonna walk away. For some of you, maybe God doesn't feel distant, but your view of God is that he is critical, that he is just up there waiting, knowing, and expecting you to screw up, and that he's the type of God who reminds you of all the times you've screwed up, and the voice that you hear in your head that reminds you of God is a God who is constantly disappointed in you. A God who is constantly shaking his head in disgust at how little you're able to be faithful to the things that he's called you to. Here's an example to understand whether or not your view of God is critical. How you read scripture The voice you hear when you're reading Jesus' voice can tell you, if you have a view of God, that he is a critical God. Most of us are familiar with the story of Jesus walking on the water. For those of you who aren't, a big storm came, the disciples are all in a boat, and all of a sudden, in the midst of this storm, they see this figure walking on the water. And the disciples are like freaked out because that's not normal. Like, things don't walk on water, and so they're like, it's a ghost. And then Peter is like, I think it's the Lord. Maybe it's Jesus. And so he calls out, and he's like, if it's you, God, like, tell me, and like, I'll come out and walk on water, because that's apparently what we do now. And so Jesus is like, it's me, come on out. And so Peter does. He gets out of the boat. He's walking on the water. The waves get bigger. He starts to get freaked out. He begins to sink, and he cries out, Lord, save me. How you read or how you hear Jesus' response to Peter at this moment can tell you whether or not you have a view of God being critical. Because what Jesus says next is, you of little faith, why did you doubt? And you can hear those words, Peter, seriously? After everything we've been through, after everything I've taught you, I was right there the entire time. You of little faith, why? Why'd you doubt me? Right? Or you could hear it differently. You could hear a Jesus who looks at Peter, the only one who risked, the only one willing to get out of the boat, and you could hear Jesus' words a little differently. You have little faith, dude. Like, what happened? What happened out there? You had it. Why'd you start doubting? Hey, we'll try again, right? But you were the only one who got out, and I'm so proud of you. You see the difference? If your view of God is that he is critical of you, that he's most concerned about all of the ways that you are letting him down, he is not a God that you are going to put your roots down in, and he is not a God that you are going to cling to when the storms come. That view of God is sand. Or maybe you'll resonate with this. This was my understanding when I first became a Christian in high school, was that God was a little bit hard to please, right? Like, and I would try to do anything and everything. I was at the church all the time. I was in the Bible studies. I was in the small groups. I did the worship band. I did all of the things. But what hung me up was this misunderstanding of Jesus hanging on the cross, dying for our sins, and crying out, my God, why have you forsaken me? And in that one verse, I interpreted quite a bit about who I thought God was. That if he could turn his back on his own son, then what choice, what chance did I have? That after everything Jesus did, right? What's to stop him from doing the same to me? And maybe you feel that way. Like you're constantly just trying to make sure that you're in good standing with God. You're constantly trying to be perfect. You're constantly trying to earn his love, his grace, his forgiveness. But what if that is sand too? What if that's not actually this rock of who Jesus actually is? What if Jesus actually never turns his back on us? You see, when I started looking at the full story of Scripture, that's when my understanding of God became this full view of what the gospel is, who he is. And because of that, I have found a rock that is secure. A God that I can dig my roots deep into. and a God that can help me withstand the storms of this life. You see, here's who he is. For those of you who may not be familiar, or for those of you who have a view of God as being distant or critical or hard to please, our God is a God who pursues, and he has since the very beginning. So in the beginning, Adam and Eve are in the garden, and they sin, they mess up. And instead of God saying, "I can't have anything to do with you, you sinners, you unholy people, you let me down, what's wrong with you?" Instead, he enters into the garden and simply asks, "Where are you?" He pursues them. He calls them out of hiding. Now, there's natural consequences that happen with sin. They were kicked out of the garden, but God didn't abandon them. God didn't leave them. He stayed with them. And so God's people are rescued out of Egypt, and they're sent into the desert land, and God is present to his people through a thing called the tabernacle, the structure that was created, that God's presence could be there, and he would lead his people with a cloud of smoke by day and a pillar of fire by night. He was present to his people who were rebellious, who worshiped other gods, who moaned and groaned and complained and wished they were back in Egypt in slavery. He stayed with them, leading and guiding, constantly pursuing, constantly trying to get closer and closer and closer. And the tabernacle was this movable structure. And so by the time they enter into the promised land, he has his people build a temple, a steady, solid place. And in that temple was the Holy of Holies, where his presence was constant. He was always there. He was always with his people. But that wasn't enough. It wasn't close enough for our God who pursues. And so he sent his son. He sent the fullness of who he is, the exact representation of who he is in Jesus Christ, to come and live amongst his people, to be tangible, human, flesh, living and eating and breathing amongst his people, showing his people what it looks like to live out this life, to be faithful. And even that wasn't close enough. God wanted to be closer. So Jesus gets crucified on the cross. He dies for our sins. He reconciles the relationship once and for all. And then God sends the Holy Spirit, his presence, to actually live and dwell within us, that we would have 24/7 access to God, that he would be as close as he could possibly get. And I don't know about you. I don't know if you've ever thought about what it would be like when you get to heaven, and maybe who are the people that you would want to talk to when you immediately get there, right? Like, is it David? Like, how'd you do it with the stones? Were you afraid? Like, he was a really big dude and you just had rocks. Like, how'd you do that? Or maybe it's Moses and you're like, what was it like when that sea split in two and you could walk through? And what about like when you saw like Pharaoh's army coming after you? Like, what were you feeling in that moment? But I guarantee you, before you can ask your questions, the heroes of our faith, the people that we talk stories about, they're going to rush up to you, and they're going to ask you, what was it like? What was it like to have the God of the universe inside of you? What was that like? What was it like to have him leading and guiding you, being ever present, never
leaving you, never forsaking you, being constantly there, reminding you of his presence, reminding you of your acceptance, of your worth, of your value, of how loved you are. What was that like? You see, this is the rock, this God who is present, this God who pursues, this God who has constantly been doing whatever he possibly can to be as close as possible to his children. And this God alone, is someone who can get you through the storms of life. And I know. I've been through some. And I could tell you about the storm of being the only Christian in my family when I was in high school. I could tell you about that storm, about what it was like when my parents used church against me, and that was my punishment, that I couldn't go to church if I messed up or did anything wrong. I could tell you about the storm of dealing with 20 years of debilitating migraines and health problems. I could tell you about that storm. I could tell you about the storm of breaking off an engagement and canceling a wedding, and then actually marrying the guy a year later. Yeah. Yeah. Thank you. Thanks. Yeah. Yeah. We have a flair for the dramatic. I could tell you about the storm of our first couple of years of marriage. Wasn't great. I could tell you about the storm of weathering church hurt over and over and over again. I could tell you about the storm of being a female in ministry and people telling me directly to my face that I'm going to hell for doing the things that I'm doing. People getting up and walking out when I take the stage. I could tell you about those storms. But instead, I want to tell you about a storm that I'm in right now. Because if I'm honest, it's one thing to hear about storms that people have been through, but it's a whole other thing to hear about a storm that somebody's currently in. Because for many of you, you're in the midst of your storm. You're in the midst. You're not through it. You're not on the other side. You don't know what's coming. And so what do you do then? What do you do in those moments? Here's what I can tell you. All of the storms that I faced up until now have caused my roots to slowly but surely, inch by inch, go deeper and deeper, clinging to Jesus, clinging to the rock, not becoming destroyed by any of the storms that have come my way, getting to know God in such a way to recognize that he is with me, that he is for me, that he sees me, that he grieves alongside of me in the midst of my storm, that he is a personal God, a God who is able to take all of my anger, all of my doubt, all of my frustration, all of my questions. And because of that, I can share with you about the storm that I'm currently in. And it's a storm that's been going on for 7.5 years now. You see, when my husband and I did get married, we were older. We were in our 30s, and we knew that we wanted to start a family. And so we started pretty quickly trying to have a kid. And it wasn't working. And so after a year of trying and nothing happening, we started seeing specialists and starting medications and a few surgeries, operations. And then we had a miscarriage. And then we decided that we would do 3 infertility treatments. And whatever happened at the end of that, we would be done. And we would, if we didn't get pregnant, we would start our family another way. And on that 3rd and final fertility treatment, we got pregnant with twins. And after 3 years of trying, it was an incredible blessing. But really early on in the pregnancy, I was diagnosed with something called hyperemesis, which is severe morning sickness, which is throwing up all day, every day, until the babies are born. Princess Kate has the same issue, so basically, I'm a princess. But here's what I need you to know, is I cried more tears on the other side of my answered prayer of longing to become a mother than I ever cried praying the prayers. I was so sick. I was on bed rest. I was miserable. I'm crying out to God, like, why can't any of this just be easy? Like, why can't I have one of those pregnancies that's like, oh my God, I love being pregnant. I feel so beautiful. I'm like, bleh, you know, the whole time. And we had scares along the way, and thankfully we delivered the boys and they were healthy. We have twin boys. And after that, my husband and I, we were good. We're like, 2-for, you know, we got 2 and 1. Like, we only want 2 kids. This is amazing. We didn't think we could get pregnant. We're solid. And for about a year after the boys were born, I was really sick. We didn't know why, and went to a lot of specialists, and finally got to a place where I invited some people to just pray. Like, if something spiritual is going on here, I want to know about it. Maybe something else is happening that the doctors can't identify. So my husband starts praying for me, and he hears the word rebellion. And I was like, excuse me? Like, do you want to sleep on the couch? Like, what are you talking about? I am not rebellious. I love Jesus and say yes. And immediately, I felt like the Lord was like, are you going to ask me if you're done having kids? And I said, no. I am not going to ask you, because if your answer is try again, I can't. I can't do that to my boys. I can't do another 9 months of sickness. Like, we're good, God. But we prayed and we wrestled and for months got to a place where we're like, we're just going to be open-handed. You're just asking us to surrender. We can do that. You're not saying we're actually going to have another kid. And the next month, we were pregnant. But then we lost that baby. And 2 months later, we got pregnant again. And we lost that baby. And at this point, I'm angry. Like, I didn't even want this journey. I didn't want to say yes. I told you, God, we were done. And now all I want is another baby. And a couple months went by, and we got pregnant again. And it was a healthy pregnancy. And we have our 3rd little boy.
But once again, that entire pregnancy, I was sick. In and out of the hospital. I got COVID at 35 weeks pregnant, had to be rushed to the hospital, risk of either myself or the baby or both of us dying. And thankfully, everything was good, and he's healthy. And 2 months after he was born, much to my husband's chagrin, I'm like, I don't think we're done. I think we're supposed to have another kid. And my husband's like, you're not thinking straight. It's the lack of sleep. That's not happening. And I'm like, I just think we need to be open. I think we need to pray about it. And so finally, a year goes by, and my husband's like, all right, okay, I think we can try for another. That week, we were pregnant. This is like, you know, the talk on all the talks, right? Like, I know how it works. You do too. And you can get pregnant after one time. So, all that aside, tuck that in the back pocket. So we get pregnant. And it's right before we had, like, just gone through our third church community where we lived in Missouri, falling apart. Us planning on becoming church planters, Johnson University offering me the job to become campus minister, us deciding to take that and move our family to Knoxville, Tennessee. I find out the day before we're packing the moving truck to leave that I'm pregnant. And I think I about broke my husband. He was like, I know I said, let's go for it, but this is too soon. And how in the world are we gonna do this? So we move. And I'm sick. And we get started in our new life in Knoxville. And in February, I went in for my second ultrasound. And they said there was no longer a heartbeat. And at this point, if you're counting, I have more babies in heaven than I do in my arms. And there's something about that reality that makes me a little frustrated, a little sad, questioning, wondering why. Like, what are you doing in all of this? Where are you in all of this? And slowly but surely, everything that I tried to make a rock, I realized was sand. That a positive pregnancy test would lead to a healthy baby, sand. That being incredibly sick would mean that I would have a healthy baby, sand. That seeing the baby's heartbeat on the ultrasound would mean I would have a healthy baby. Sand. It was all sand. But my husband and I knew that we weren't done. And call us fools, call us whatever, but we knew our family wasn't complete. And so the day after Mother's Day, as I sat there in the reality of what this storm has been, we found out we were pregnant again. And I'm currently 10 weeks. Yeah. And I'm so incredibly sick. I threw up backstage. I was in the ER on Sunday. And here's where I'm at. In the midst of my storm, having no idea what's going to happen. No idea. But trusting in this rock that has kept me steady
the rock where my roots have gone down deep, where all of the sand has been stripped away. And I am left with who I know my God to be. And he is good. And he is for me. And he is with me. No matter what happens to this child, he is good. No matter how many times I throw up and end up in the ER, he is good. Whether this ends in a healthy baby or not, he is good. And I know that because I've been through storms before and I've survived. And I will keep surviving because he's worth it. Now listen, I know that the majority of you in this room cannot fully relate to this storm of mine. But you know what a storm looks like. You know what a storm feels like. Where everything you thought was secure, everything you thought you could hold on to, slips through your fingers and you're left with a bunch of questions and doubts, and wondering, is any of this real? Is any of this secure? Is he strong enough? Can I really trust him with what's going on in my life? And I'm here to tell you tonight that you can. He is good. No matter if your prayers are answered in the way that you think they should, when they should be answered. No matter if the ceiling caves in and it feels like your world is falling apart, he is there. He is with you. He is for you. He loves you. You have a choice. You can continue to hold on to the things of this world or a false reality that God is distant or critical or hard to please, and you will end up like the foolish builder who built their house on sand. And when the rains came and the winds blew and the flood raised, it was utterly and completely destroyed. Or you can choose to put your trust and your hope in the one true God who has been for you since the beginning of time, pursuing your heart, knowing your pain, knowing your struggle, and asking to be with you in it. And you could be like the wise builder who built their house on a rock, who had a firm foundation to plant their feet on, whose roots went deep, so that when the storms come, and they will, and the winds blow and the rains come, you will not be destroyed. You will stand firm because he is good. It's your choice. Let's pray.